Oh yeah, I love that look right there. That whole glass. I love that look.
This?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
All right, we live now.
It's called I Can't See.
Yeah. All right. Good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome to Good Vibes Television. That's right, Gvtv, for our 18th episode. I am one of your hosts. I'm your man, Ramon, R-L, a.k.a. Moan. Doesn't matter as long as you put Mr. in front of it, I'll be there for you. Once again, I'm here with my man, DJ PRS1. And the lovely Savvy E. And we have a special guest tonight looking very educated and sensual, just gorgeous and everything. I'm feeling that look. Miss Savvy E, can you please introduce our guest?
Yes, yes. Hi, everybody. So we got Miss Fern back. She was on one of our shows a couple of weeks ago, our special Father's Day show. So let's welcome her back. How you doing, Miss Fern?
Hi, everyone.
Hey.
Can you let everybody know, you know, your information, where to find you, what you do, and everything? We just want to thank you again for coming in and joining us for this special topic tonight.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, so my name is Fern Burke. I work as a nurse currently, but I'm also an entrepreneur. I have my own business where I connect people through networking in all different industries. I also, I work, you know, closely with some music artists. I work closely with investors, real estate agents, you know, credit repair, you name it. There is not really anyone I'm not working with. I'm also very into mindset and, you know, energy and vibrations. And I love what you guys are doing over here. And I'm just like, just so happy to be back.
Ooh. Well, happy to have you. Happy to have
yep.
you.
Thank you. Thank
you. Said
you.
Vibrations. Good Vibes TV.
Yes.
So tonight we are going to discuss the challenge of interracial dating or interracial relationship, right? The challenge of interracial relationship. It's 2020. Well, I feel like we always say it's 2020.
Hey, but before we start, Moan, you're in your car. Where you at?
I'm in the car, man.
They're interested in where you at.
Oh, well, once again, I got to be a good father. I'm at my son's baseball practice. Instead of being out walking around, I actually got the car parked right beside the field so I can watch him practice and do this stuff.
All right. And I'm coming from y'all from beautiful Ocean City. We out here to see the ocean. It's a little rainy out here, but that's where we at, Ocean City.
I'm over here on Long Island. And on Long Island in New York.
Ooh. Any iced tea? Long Island.
Yes, yes, yes.
So people. So
yeah, now we can go ahead with the topic.
I was thinking about this today, and I'm gonna be honest with you. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm 41. I've you know, done lived a diverse life. This really isn't a big deal to me, but still it's one that so many people struggle because, you know, they date outside their race. And it's really unfortunate, but it happens. I've always, and not to say, I had relationships with, I've dated a Japanese woman. I dated a white, I've dated lots of white women. I've dated a Hispanic woman. Biracial woman. I've dated all kinds of just women. And I really didn't see no difference in them outside of their appearance. That was it. You know, but I will say this. There was always one thing that separated non-black women and black women. And it was how I was treated, okay? How I was treated, like, you know, and I don't want to say black women, like, because I'm married. I ain't saying that black women have, you know, treat me bad, but I always, like, it's like, for instance, like, I was always thought of, no matter what. No matter what, I was always thought of. Even when I wasn't in the house, say there was a party or something, and people came over and they went to reach for the Bud Ice, you know, the young lady was like, no. No one can have a Bud Ice until Moan get home. And I was like, wow. Because a black woman would let her cousins have all the malt liquor. You dig what I'm saying? I'd have been drinking, you know, some Natty Bo. You dig what I'm saying? So that was the only, other than that, you know, maybe that's a significant one, but I don't know. DJ PRS what? I see you smiling.
Oh, Lord. Yeah, I mean, I've dated, you know, I'm outside of my race. Well, my race is all mixed up anyway, because I'm, you know, half black, half Indian. So I don't even know what you call me. Douglas, in Trinidad, they call them Douglas when you mix with Indian and black. So that's what I'm at. I'm a Douglas. But I've briefly, when I was in the military, I had Caucasian girlfriends. I've also had black girlfriends. And I swear, the black girlfriends is where I had the most little. I mean, we talked about that in one of the shows where I had an issue with that, with, you know, my parents and stuff. But and I think that's where this topic came from. But I guess I'm interested in this topic because now, especially Moan, you and I spoke about this. Remember one day we were standing on my porch and we were talking about, you know what, they're talking about all this Black Lives Matter stuff, and all this stuff is going on, all this racism is coming all the way back. And we were saying, but you also got to watch out for your white friends. Your white friends are also going to get victimized because of this. Oh, you're an N-word lover. You know what I mean? This kind of thing. And this is, a lot of that stuff is going to come right back. So it's like, it's history repeating itself. We talked about it. You know, we got to watch out for our white friends that support us and all this kind of crazy stuff. You know, it's one world, but people just hard-headed.
Yeah. I feel like, to be honest, we're trying to dance around the subject. I think we've been too much with this. I think that this is a topic that we really need to be open and honest about. As far as me, I grew up in different types of neighborhoods. So I grew up in an all-black neighborhood. I grew up around white and black people, Mexican, Spanish, things like that. I never dated a white guy. We was friends. I had like a close friend. We hang out. And the thing about it, when I was dating him, as far as dating, but not, we weren't together, I lived in a black neighborhood. And the thing that was impressive with me, with him, was he was not afraid to come to the neighborhood. I mean, I got all the eyes and stuff, and everybody like basically was like, so you going to date him and you won't date nobody around here? And a lot of times people didn't realize he was white, you know, until they saw him. If they talked to him on the phone, he didn't sound white. He didn't, you know, he didn't act like he was like that. And when you knew his history, it's because he hung around a lot of black people. And he always said, you know, he would always have to defend himself about, it's not that I don't like white women or anything like that. I just like black women. You know, that's what I prefer. You know, and so most of his friends was black. That's who he hung around with. So it was weird because he was tall with freckles and red hair. And for someone like that to be in an all-black neighborhood, he stuck out like a sore thumb. But he was cool. He was really, really cool. It just never went anywhere but us hanging out and dating and going out to the movies and stuff like that. We never made that connection. But I never, outside of that, I never dated outside of my race. Not that I didn't like it. I mean, I wouldn't love to when I was younger. You know, I just never did.
Did y'all do anything? Was this just a friendship?
It was a friendship. It was
no
like
kissing, no hugging, no pants rubbing.
No, he was like a best friend at that time. He was like, and the thing about it was funny because when he called me and when he first started calling me, I couldn't remember where I met this guy at. He had to really tell me like where I met him at. And then when he came to my neighborhood, he had a black 5.0, and he was banging house music. So when he came down the street, people thought he was a black guy. When he kept, when he got out the car and walked, they was like, we gonna get her when he leaves.
Yeah.
For me, you know, I went to an all white high school. And I'm like Whitey McWhite. Like, it doesn't really get much more white than me. and so, huh?
Yeah, I think my
hey, Mac, you did. You went. You yeah, went.
Mike
off,
went off. Mike.
Yeah.
My so Mike went off.
No, Mac. Mike went off. I, for a minute there, I thought she was doing like some, you know, puppet thing. With I thought your voice was coming out of her mouth. I was like, wait a minute.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you now.
Yeah, it's just computer stuff. But it was time in his life where he was raising his sister. It was just him and his sister, so he worked a lot. So it was enough. We couldn't have nothing but a friendship at the time. But he was a good guy.
Okay. All right, Fern, go ahead and legitimately say what you were saying now.
I was saying that for me, I went to an all-white high school. And, like, I'm, you know, like I was saying, I'm Whitey McWhite. Like, there's no kind of, you know, melanin in my DNA. But going to an all-white high school and dating interracially, I got with my children's father when I was, you know, young. And, you know, I got called the names, you know, one of them like that, the name Wigger and, you know, all these different things. I just was never a person that really cared. But, you know, I also, too, get from a lot of the men how, you know, they'll say things like, you know, black women are just too strong. They will never say too strong, but they'll be like, oh, they're too argumentative, or they're too
aggressive.
Thank you. Yeah, aggressive. Mm-hmm. And to be honest with you, I find offense in that as well, because so you're saying because you think I'm a pushover that you think you're going to come talk over here. Like, no, you know what I mean? And for me, you know, Savvy, you had said, you know, we really need to be open and honest. And I really strongly agree with that, because these are conversations that we need to have, because stereotypes have been formed out of this. And I personally feel like the biggest gap right now between the two races are between black women and white women. We've been pinned against each other, you know, well, she does this better and she does that better. And she looks like this better. And she looks that like that better. And she's stealing my culture and she's stealing my hair, or she's, you know what I mean? And I feel like that's making us constantly, as women already, we're all so hard on one another, but then now you add in the differences of our cultures. So I feel that's where the biggest gap is because a lot of times we're told we're not good enough from the men, you know, based upon what we look like or based upon our culture. And I just think it's unfair.
And that will conclude our show, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for tuning in. You know what? I agree with both of you. You hit on some very strong points, you know, because, you know, I have a friend who, you know, that's why he said he do not like dating black women. He said they argue, they're too aggressive. You know, he's never used the word, you know, strong. They argue, they're too aggressive, you know, and stuff like that. Look, I'm a black man. I'm married to a black woman. She doesn't argue. We don't argue, you know, none of that stuff. But I have dated black women who, man, they're just so tough. And sometimes it makes it difficult. I don't like to argue. I'm a peaceful person. I'm just real laid back and chill. I like to be able to come home and just chill. And unfortunately, you know, you have people, and I know our black women are painted as these individuals a lot of the time, you know, that when you come home, the first thing, this motherfucker here and this shit, and this, you know what, this bitch at work, and I, you know what, I ain't got time for this shit, you know what, look, I need some fucking time, I'm, you know, and this, and for some men, that is just too much, mm-hmm. That's just too much, so they normally go on the other side of the tracks, and they date a white woman. I'm going to tell you right now, I have a black homeboy who would not come on the show tonight because he's scared to death of his white wife. this motherfucking is angry. She's angrier than any black woman I've ever known. They got into an argument one time, and she, like, put all this sexual business out at the cookout. I ain't never heard no stuff like that before. She was angry. Angry. So, don't sleep on white women.
That's what I'm saying. Like, listen, you pissed me off, like... My temper will come out, you know? Like, don't think just because I'm white that I am a pushover. That's why I take offense to that, because, you know, to make that assumption, you're going to be very well, you know, misinformed. And you're going to find out just how misinformed.
So, Ms. Fern.
Yes.
Like, just tell me, like, some experiences that you had dating black men, you know, like, with, like, outside of, like, was your son father the only black man you ever dated, or?
No, I've never dated a white man.
Okay.
I've only dated black men. It's just how it happened, you know? I was with my children's father for about 22 years. He passed away 5 years ago. And then I just, you know, dated another gentleman for about 2.5, close to 3 years. And, I'm not against anybody, you know what I mean? We attract who we attract, and we like what we like. But I would date a white man. I have no problem dating a white man. It just so happens, I think right now the space that I'm at, the people that I'm around, I'm more likely to date a black man.
Mm. I like
and that. I love hip hop, so there's that.
Well, I know that because I've seen your face. That's what we got in common.
right. Like, and I love it because I love it, not because it's the because let me tell you, I was in high school, all of my classmates and my friends, like, it wasn't like I was this loner. I had a lot of friends. And they were all like into Nirvana and, like, you know, the whole Soundgarden, like the whole grunge scene. And here I come with, like, you know, Tribe Called Quest, Leaders of the New School, and they're like, wait, what, you know, Poor Righteous Teachers. They're
drop them songs, that's right.
Right, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And, like,
they don't know nothing about that.
I thoroughly enjoyed it, you know what I mean? Like, it wasn't a fad to me, because I'm pretty much the only one doing it, and, you know, kind of like being the trendsetter, you know, this is before hip-hop even became, like, I don't think people really understand, hip-hop was not, like, what it is today, you know, back in like the early 90s, hip hop was not, huh?
I said, don't drop them lessons on, they don't understand.
I'm really showing my age here, but you know.
Go ahead.
So, you know, so for me, I loved it because I loved it. So naturally, if you're going to go into that type of scene, you're going to be around that type of crowd of people with those same interests. More than likely, I'm going to be around, you know, men that are, you know, got a little melanin in them, you know, just a smidge.
Right. Right.
So, and I'm not complaining at all. I'm just saying, I just want to be clear, I wasn't complaining.
Oh, no. I support that. Black penises matter.
Right. But I will also tell you this.
You didn't hear what he said, Fern.
No, I'm sorry.
He said black penises matter.
Oh, well, they do, but yeah. Well.
Oh, wow.
But let me tell you, that's a myth, too, but we'll get, that's a whole nother story and a whole nother show.
Ooh, she said that's a myth. Wait a minute.
That's a myth. Hold on. Hold on. I ain't gonna do that.
right, chocolate. So, but, I got Ms. Betran on here. And she says, thanks, Betran, for watching every week. She said, first white guy I ever dated was when I was in active duty. She said, I was enlisted and he was a senior NCO, so we had to be sneaky, LOL. I remember him telling me that he had always been attracted to black women since he was a kid. And his family could never understand that.
Sure, I could. You know what? You got a lot of people. And PRS1, you know that, being in the military. You meet so many different people around the world. And because I came across white guys and well, white men and women whose mm-hmm. whole family was racist.
Right.
And they got away from them, joined the military, and they were just really curious about mm-hmm. the other side and, you know, yep. all the stuff that they was raised up on and taught and maybe things they have seen. Mm-hmm. It was like, man, I don't see what the big deal is. You know, you're just right. like me. And
now you finally you had know, to, because in the military, they don't realize, you don't realize, but you're not, you don't just meet up and work with these people. You live with these people. Yeah. So you're living with a whole nother race that you're not used to living with. And you realize, wait a minute, we do the same thing. It's not yes. that bad. I can have a conversation with this person, and it's a good conversation. They're educated. You know what I mean? It's a whole bunch of stuff that they weren't exposed to. They weren't taught when they're young, and they realize, but there's nothing wrong with this person. Wait a minute, I'm starting to really like this person. Should I? You know what I mean? It's one of those things that when it's again, I always quote my Janet Jackson, but and when what Janet Jackson said, in complete darkness, we're all the same. You know what I mean?
So, damn right.
I mean, if we all couldn't see, we were all blind, how would we know what color someone was? You know
and
I mean?
That's exactly. it. I think we get so caught up on stereotypes and
yes, you know, and color.
Right, and color, absolutely. When at the end of the day, we're more alike than we're not.
Right, you know? And most of the time we fall with somebody, it's not their color, it's more their personality. It's
absolutely.
What they bring to the table. The conversations I can have. I mean, you know, stuff like that. You know, it's. I guess, you know, finding a nice girlfriend versus finding a thought. You know, it's
right.
It's all what you're concerned, what you want, you know, when you want
absolutely.
To hook up. Right.
You know, but I want to be honest about something. I have not seen, and no disrespect to nobody, a Caucasian guy that I was, like, really attracted to outside of television. And I always say that. Like, I never, came across a white guy that was out. I was like, wow, I want to, you know, date him, or I think he's attractive. I just never did. I don't know. It's not, like, something that, you know, because of prejudice or anything like that. I just never did. If I ain't seen him on television, like, I don't know.
And there are people, there are, like, you know, you'll hear, like, black love and, like, you know, they support, you know, staying with inside their race. I don't find anything wrong with that either. If people want to just, you know, if I'm a white person and I just want to date another white man, I don't think that there's anything wrong with that. That doesn't make me a racist. It doesn't make that person a racist, or, you know, vice versa. You know, that's just, to me, it's all about preference. Yeah. It's what, you know, what mm-hmm. you like. Right. You, know, you may like.
I'm very attracted to, like, Mexican and Spanish, especially Cubans. My God, I used to go crazy about Ricky Ricardo. I put myself a Ricky Ricardo.
Yeah,
I went to school with Caucasian, so it wasn't, you know, they were friends and they taught me stuff, but it was just like, you know, that's how I learned how to get into Linkin Park and all that kind of stuff, because of them. You know, I love rock music and metal and stuff like that. So even though, you know, hip hop is my core, you know, I can listen to practically anything. You know, sometimes right. I come to work and I'm rocking Linkin Park and people at work be like, really? Like, really, Savanya? And then my thing is because I love music. It's not right, about a culture thing. It's so my thing is I get into music, you know, because sometimes I can really listen to some hard rock. Like, sometimes it's my mood. It's whatever mood I am is what music I'm going to play. But I just never was, and it's like I didn't never see anything wrong with them. It was just me, you know. Like I said, Mexican, Spanish, Cuban, the Lord.
Let me tell you, how I got put onto hip hop. It's actually pretty funny. I was like headbanger ball, like first edition, hair spiked, you name it. And then we went to like this teen club, and they were playing like all house music, and I was like, oh, I get to shake my hips. Oh, that's a whole new thing. Oh, okay. And then I got introduced. Uncle Luke. What were they called?
Two Live Crew.
Two Live Crew. I mean, of all people, I'm like, Two Live. I'm like, oh my God, this is so great. And then, and literally. And then, a kid in my school that, you know, was like one of the random, you know, like only other white kids that listen to hip hop. He gave me, this is when we were able to make tapes. Remember we were able to like the cassette tapes? Mm-hmm. He gave me a cassette tape of KRS-One and Brand Nubian. And that was it. I got a hold of Brand Nubian. You couldn't tell me nothing.
There you go. That's right.
That was it. Well,
and KRS-One was pretty vigilant when it comes to racism and slavery. And
right.
All
well,
he was a
right.
real like, prophet type teacher type thing.
So yeah, imagine this little white girl in high school, like, hey, you know.
Stop the violence.
You know, like, the bridge is over, guys. The bridge is over. My friends were like, what?
That's what's up. I have.
You're scaring us.
This one story. So, like I said, I grew up. Now, this is clean. This is clean.
Okay.
I grew up in a private school. Okay. So I had a number of white friends, Vietnamese kids, Korean kids, whatever. So come high school, I went to an all-black high school. Okay, I got away from it. I felt like I needed to be around more of my people because I, you know, was in a diverse setting my whole life. So I'm still keeping in contact with my, you know, white friends, my Korean friends and so forth. And one of my friends, her name was Anna. And she was Korean, and Anna was gorgeous. I mean, drop dead gorgeous. And she, because she was built like, I hate to say it, one of them Luke girls. She was gorgeous, Korean chick. And she went to Western. She went to an all black high school. And she asked me to go to her Valentine's Day dance, and I was like, hell yeah, I'll go with you. I mean, we were already banging, so I mean, we done banged before, so I mean. You know, so I go with her because I do like her. She liked me. We've been on and off. And this was my first experience of actually like going out on a date with somebody outside of my race. So she picked me up. We drive there. I'm feeling really, really good about this date. Once again, we've been together before, so I know I'm getting something in the night. And she's thick as hell. We're walking up the path and to the high school, and it dawns on me, it's a black high school. There could be nothing but black girls in here. And we go into the school, and it's like everybody put the light on us. And I knew it wasn't like, oh, they are a handsome couple. That was not the thought on their face. All these were walking by, and I'm looking good. I'm looking fly. I had the champion sweater on, the polo underneath it. I was looking great, but they weren't looking at me because I was looking good. And we're walking by, and I'm turning, and I'm hearing voices. And mm-hmm. I'm like, you know, I'm hearing sellout. I'm hearing, yes. Oh, my God, why he here with this chink? You know, oh, ew. Oh, he don't like black girls. I'm hearing all of this now. Mind you, I felt bad now because I was being selfish. I wasn't going through it by myself. She was going through it too.
Mm-hmm.
But I've never, ever experienced my first time experience. So we go in there, we go to the dance floor, right? And she asked if I wanted something to drink. And I was like, nah, I'm good. You know, I really didn't want her to leave my side because I didn't want anybody walking over to me saying some shit and I'd get into a fight. So, the OJs come on, and I'm like, oh God, it's her favorite song. And I'm like, shit, she asked to dance. So we're on the dance floor, we're dancing chest to chest. I was trying to dance like, you know, 5 feet, 6 feet apart, you know, social distance and shit. And she lay her head on my shoulder, and I'm like, God, please do not let her kiss me.
Why?
On the dance floor, huh?
Why?
Because I knew what the hell was going to happen. I knew what was going to happen. And she brings her head up, and I'm like, oh, shit, this is, and this is a true story. And she kissed me, but I kissed her back. I kissed her back, right? And I was holding her, and I'm kissing her, and I remember I thought to myself, I'm like, man, fuck them. This is my date. This is my girl. Fuck them. Fuck it. It is what it is. So we went on.
Okay. Yeah. They say you kissed the black.
We went on and had a great night, but it was my first experience, man. I just
right.
I mean, people I didn't know was just coming for us, and I was just like, wow, you know. it didn't matter that she was thick as hell at that. I ain't gonna lie, I could care less. She could have been motherfucking anorexic as hell. The way people were coming for us, and I was only 17, I was like, damn, is this what it's going to be like if I choose to stay with her?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's how it usually is when black men date outside of their race. They always say that they're a sellout. They say that, you know, they're weak, they can't handle a black woman, things like that. And even the same for black women dating Caucasian men or any other man outside their race. But I think that the black man gets it harder when it comes, when they date outside of their race. Not even if it's a Caucasian. If you dated a Korean, if you dated, you know, a Spanish woman, anything like that. It's like we came down on y'all much harder. We like y'all because you can't handle us. You can't handle our strength. You can't, you know. And the thing about it is we as black women have to learn how to come down on some of the aggression, the aggressiveness. I can't say the word for some reason. We have to learn how to come down from that because we think that is the, that's who we need to be when it comes to showing our strength. And it's not, you know, I listen to a lot of black men talk about that. I do get offended. I'm never not going to get offended when black men put black women down when they're mm-hmm. dating another race, because I don't think you have to do that. Date whoever you feel like you want to date, whoever you fall in love, that's your preference. But the point is I feel like you don't have to bring down your race because you're dating someone else outside of that race. But as black women, I came to the point like, I don't care. Love who you love, be whoever you want to be with. It don't matter mm-hmm. to me. It's exactly. just that we get into these conversations. I'm a person that you have to be a realist. And if you're not talking real to me and you're telling me that somebody else is better because of this, that, and the other, then that's when you're going to have a problem with me. You can't mm-hmm. tell me that a Caucasian or a Spanish woman or anything is better than a black woman. You're never going to tell me that. So mm-hmm. that's when my problem come in, you know. I have no problem with you.
But why does it have to be better?
Because that's yeah. what they. Because
no,
that's
and, what I, they and I understand, and I understand that. That's what I mean by them always pinning them, pinning us against one another. Mm-hmm. Why does one have to be better? You know what I mean? Like, I know a lot of women will, like a lot of white women, be like, you know, they get offended really because of, you know, when a black woman's like, oh, I'm a queen, I'm this, I'm that. If that's what she wants to be, let her be what she wants to be. You know what I mean? Like, anytime that something triggers you, what another person is saying, it's got nothing to do with that other person. It's got to do with you and how you're feeling about you. Mm-hmm. You understand? So right. if that person is telling them that they're a queen and they're, you know, they're God's best creation or whatever it is that they're saying, you're thinking, you're taking it as, well, what about me? And what, you know, taking offense to it. That's because you don't feel that way about yourself. And that's got nothing mm-hmm. to do with the other person. That's got to do with you. So you need to start looking inside yourself and figure out what you got going on, you know?
But I want to say this. I feel like this, and I could be wrong. When it comes to the judgment between a different race and black women, it's always 95% of the time it's the black man that's saying that about us. You know what I'm saying? And because I rarely hear any other race putting down their women. I rarely think that. It's mostly black men putting down the black woman, you know, and that's the part, that's the problem that I have. Like I said,
I don't disagree with that. Yeah. And I don't disagree with that because, like I said, I've heard that myself, you know, white women can do this better. Black women, oh, that, you know, that black bitch ain't blah, blah, blah. No disrespect to anybody, but these are things that are said, you know, and if a lot of white women don't understand this, just because you're dating a black man doesn't necessarily mean that you're like in the culture. Do you know what I mean? And it took me a long time to understand that because I was with my children's father, but I was only around him. I wasn't around other black women. I wasn't around other black people. He was like in my circle of things, if that makes sense. Yeah. It wasn't until I went to work, I was working for the state and I was working around black women. I didn't even know that Haitians were Haitians. Like, I had met a Haitian at a club one time, and he was like, you know, he had that French type of accent that he had. And I'm asking him, oh gosh, I'm asking him, like, what's your ethnicity? He was like, what? I was like, well, where do your parents come from? He was like, France. I was like, wait, what? Now I was really confused. I was really, really confused, you know? So a lot of white people don't, it's not that like they're racist or they're prejudiced. They really just don't know because they've not been exposed to these type of things in the worlds that they live in, you know?
Yeah, but when it's like that, like far as myself, because I only speak for myself, I can't speak for the whole black woman race or whatever the case may be. I feel like this with myself, but I'm not sure or clear or have an understanding, that's when I ask.
100%.
I ask the person. I want to educate myself because I don't want to be ignorant to the fact, you know, and I don't want to seem like I'm trying to bring you down or put you down. So that's where education is, you know, come from, you know, but we lack that. We don't want to educate, you know.
Right. And I was very fortunate.
Right. We want to sit around and put each other down. You know, right. Real conversations about that needs to, you know, need to be had. Even like what you said between black women and white women, because I'm going to be honest, it is a culture difference, but even with that culture difference, we can learn how to exist with each other, and that's the problem, you know? And we need to stop letting these men tell us who better than whoever.
Right.
Because yes, I am a queen. Right. But also,
We're going to cut you off.
You know, as me being a queen, I'm more than that. Because I'm a creation, the creation made of God. So
right.
I look at myself like that. But that don't mean that I think that I'm better than anybody else. You know, that's where education come in.
I agree with you 100%. We have to break these stereotypes. You know, we are the only really the color is such a big deal. For instance, this term culture vultures, right? So you'll hear a lot of people say, oh, these white people come in and they're taking these culture vultures. But when you really start breaking it down, okay, you have hip hop, which is probably the biggest platform for music right now, okay? You have these white suburbia kids who don't have any kind of understanding what hip hop really is or where it really came from. All they know is that this is the hottest thing, it's trending, my friends like it, I like to dance to it, and so they pick up on it, as every generation of kids has done, you know, whether it was rock, whether it was, you know, the hippie music, the whole hippie scene, whatever the music was, those kids picked up on that. That definitely influenced them. Now it's hip hop. And so of course they're going to start like Kim Kardashian. I think there was a whole big thing about Kim Kardashian and the braids that she was wearing. We call them boxer braids. Why? Because that's how I used to call them French braids. When I was a little girl, my mother would put two, you know, part my hair down the middle and do two French braids down, you know, down my hair. That was how we were taught. That's what we were exposed to. That's what we knew. Now, going forward, clearly it comes from, you know, African-American women. It comes over from, you know, from Africa. You start doing your research. There's no reason not to know with the internet, with Google, and so on and so forth. But Kim Kardashian has said they are the Bo Derek braids.
And they're not.
It's not. No, it's not. But for her, it was, because that's what she was exposed to. It was Bo Derek who put them on the scene for her in the movie. I think it was called 9 or 6 or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever it was.
Right. I remember her running on the beach with the braids. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
The main movie that put her on the map.
Right. Yeah, right.
Absolutely.
And Bo Derek said she got them from her stylist, which was an African-American. You know, they came from like Nefertiti. You know what I mean? So her stylist took them from that, you know, was inspired by Nefertiti and gave them to Bo Derek for this movie, for this scene, and so on and so forth. So this is what I think people really need to start understanding. You know, we take fashion from so many different cultures, and we're not stressing it the way we are stressing it between the African-American culture and white people. You know what I mean? If a white person takes, you know, if I was to wear some type of, and I'm going to probably get the name incorrect, so please don't, but the specific, you know, African, the dressing, you know, the shirt or whatever, I would get,
dashiki.
I'm sorry?
Dashiki?
Yes, there you go. I would get totally, like, drugged, you know what I mean? Like, oh, she thinks this, and especially knowing that I date, you know, African American men or, you know, black men would be like, oh, now she's trying to be down. Now she want to be this. Now she want to be, no, maybe I just like the color. Like, maybe it just felt like I went with my eyes today. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not always that serious or that deep. You know what I mean?
Well, let me
But I'm glad you talked about fashion. You know what's crazy about fashion? So if you wore, as a white woman, you wore the African wear, you would get flack from it. Mm-hmm. But you know what's weird? If you wore from India, let's say you wore Indian wear, exactly. Let's say a sari or the kurta or anything like that, it's called fashion, right?
Right.
But when the Indian people wear the same thing you wear, it's like they fresh off the boat.
Right.
It's no longer considered fashion. It's weird.
Right.
It's weird.
Exactly. I remember my brother wears dreads, right?
Right.
And he don't like people to touch his dreads. And he explains why. And when you were talking about, you know, wearing something of another culture, you know.
Right, right. It kind of, I guess it's the same thing.
Right, like, because now everybody's rocking dreads. But, you know, people that was called dreadheads and stuff like that, they mm-hmm. used to get offended for the simple fact that that is a culture thing for them. And a lot of times,
I think in some places, the Rastafarian religion, it's exactly. a religious thing. So, right.
My mm-hmm. thing is, like I said, once again, do what you want to do. It's just mm-hmm. educate yourself. Just
right.
educate
right.
yourself
right.
what you're doing. Because you, to be honest, Fern, when you was talking about wearing a certain garb or a certain dashiki, sometimes people do get offended because of what is the statement behind it. So.
Right.
But my thing is, once you educate yourself and understand why they feel like that, wear whatever you want to wear. But as long as you educated to know, okay, I understand why they're offended. But it's cool with my color today. It matches my eyes.
Right.
You know, so that's my whole thing. Education to me about certain things is very important. It's the fact that when you don't know and you can't defend the reason why, it's the problem. You know, mm-hmm. so.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree. And that's why we need to have these conversations and we need to talk about these things because, like I said, you know, we are so much more alike than we're not.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and this goes for white people too. You know, when this whole, you know, Black Lives Matter and, you know, with the protests and everything that's going on, I already know, you know what I mean? I have children that are black. So I have a front row seat to see the mistreatment and the things that have gone on. However, I still know that I will never experience the things that black people have to experience or had experienced. But that's, you know, with that being said, I had done a couple of lives on my Facebook, you know, like talking to white people because I got the whole all lives matter. And I'm like, why does that bother you so much? Well, that's what we need to talk about. Forget about, I'm not here to change anybody's mind. You want to think how you want to think. You want to not like who you want to like, not like, that's fine. But what you're not going to do is you're not going to disrespect and you're not going to violate people's rights, period. Mm-hmm. You know? And so why do you feel that way? What does it matter, you know, if somebody is saying Black Lives Matter? How is that affecting your life? You know what I mean? And so conversations like this really need to be had and open. And it's not just one-sided either, because I also feel like there are black people that I have come in contact with who feel like I don't have a right to say anything or I don't have a right to voice my opinion. Like, you don't experience that, so you, and that's not right either.
Yeah, I agree with you totally with that. I was on the fence for years because I just wanted, you know, peace with everyone.
Right.
And, you know, I get for the most part, the all lives matter. Cause you know, truth, yeah, all lives do matter. But you know, the last 10 years, as I've gotten older and I've taken a look at my children and I've taken a look at what's going on and just how there's no justice and it just keep happening and happening and happening and happening. And I think you get more upset with the fact that you have so many people in the world that they just don't get it. You know, they're defending something that it's like, are you serious? And I think you get more, like I said, you get more upset at the fact, like, I can't believe I'm having this conversation. Like, you just don't get it. We're not even really talking about the incident anymore. It's just like, holy shit, you just do not comprehend what has been going on. You don't see people hurt. You don't see
family
members mourning the loss of a father or a brother or a mother or something. It's irritating. Because we honestly, we know most of them playing stupid.
Mm-hmm.
They're playing stupid. You know, there's just something that they're against. You know, I wanted to jump on something, and I want to say this because you hear so many black men or non-white men say this. Reason why they beat out the race. One of the ones are to say, yeah, black women angry, just hard to get along with. You know, they got to be right. Blah blah blah. Now this is one. I'm not joking. I'm dead serious with this one. White women are more sexual.
More sexual?
More sexual.
I heard that too.
I've heard that as well. I don't know.
You just pat yourself on the back. It's all right. Ain't nobody gonna judge you.
No, I don't sleep with white women, so I don't really know. You know.
Thank you, Ms. Karen. Thank you for clearing that up.
Woo.
But I will tell you this. I do sit around the table and I do speak to women, both colors, white, black, purple, pink, whatever. And that is a very untrue statement.
Exactly. Exactly.
So I'm gonna tell you men this, okay? Women are what you bring out in them. Okay?
Damn.
So if your woman is not sexual,
that's what you
ain't doing.
That's right.
I'm just saying.
Yeah,
thank you,
Terrence. I'm about to start calling someone. Hey, Terrell, you aren't as sexual as you think you are, sir. hey, Mike, that's why she's not doing it. You ain't bringing it out of her.
Why are you putting everyone else on blast?
Right.
You're not even here to defend yourself. Why are you putting everyone on blast? Right.
Oh, talk about myself?
Yes. Really?
I could be.
Right. And I agree with Ms. Fern that it's what you bring out of a person. You know, I always say to my partners, like, I feed off of your energy. And if your energy dead, I'm going to be dead. And I'm sorry. I mean, I feed off of what you bring to the table. And if you don't bring nothing to the table, I don't know what to tell you, bro.
Listen, true story. I'm a share a little private thing here, but a true story. I was with this gentleman. We were kids. And 10 years later, my girlfriend was with him. He to me? No. Sorry if you're listening because we're still friends, but it was a no-go. With her, she thought he was the best thing since sliced bread. So, it really depends on the energy and it depends on the person. And this is where communication, and it does depend on the woman as well, because as a woman, you really need to be in touch with yourself to be open, you know, to exchange that energy. So that's definitely, you know, but if you're a man who's constantly getting these black women that you feel aren't sexual, it's the person that you're choosing. It's got nothing to do with her race. It's got nothing to do with her color. It's got to do with the fact that, you know, just like if I'm a woman that constantly getting a fuck boy, excuse my French, whose problem, like, it's, you know what I mean? That's what I'm attracting into my circle. So I have to, like, really, you know, look within inside myself to see why they keep coming to my circle.
Right, exactly.
I
didn't say nothing.
Crickets.
You have nothing
crickets.
After that? You ain't got nothing to say. So size don't matter.
Hey, Ms. Fern, this is the first time he's been speechless.
That I did not say.
Right. That's the first time he ever been speechless.
What?
I'm trying to bring you back there, bro. I say, so size don't matter.
Right.
I didn't say. That whole motion in the ocean, that's a big myth, too. So I'm just going to let that
A whole nother show.
That's a whole nother show.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord. Let me see if I can read some of these comments we got. Damn. Okay, so I got Ms. Betran again. She said, I worked with this young lady at my part-time job that is white. She just recently married a black man. I remember a couple of years ago, we were working together one night, and she says, I'm going to need some education in how to work with my child's hair because I'm not going to know what to do. Another coworker, who is black, for some reason took offense to that and told her, that she may in fact have difficulty in that area if she has a biracial child with curly hair and she has never dealt with that before. I actually just told her what product she would need to use. Yeah, and that is true. You know, you got some people like, you ain't no business having that child because you ain't know what to do. Mm-hmm. Right.
That's, you know what? That's ridiculous. Because
It is. It's one of those things.
Okay, she had a baby by a car.
Man, you did the right thing.
I mean, a black man. Just help the woman out. Just point it to the product. You know, come on. We make some things that's just so silly, so big. It's just ridiculous. Right. I can't.
Some people just want to
ain't nothing a ponytail can't fix.
Right.
There you go. Right.
You know, everything. I mean,
braid the hair, just throw it in a ponytail.
Right. Mm-hmm. Everything is not, you know, a thing to get offended by. I mean, but I've
met black women who didn't know how to comb black people's hair.
Yeah. Exactly.
Because they were so used to their mom combing their hair or somebody doing their hair. Then when it was time to do their, you know, a child's hair, somebody. They don't know how to do it. It's like, oh, I don't know. It's crazy, you know. And they always think men don't know how to do it, but men, it's something you learn to do. It's something you can teach. It's teachable. So it doesn't matter. You know what I mean? It doesn't matter what race you are. You learn to do it.
Yeah, like anything in this world, practice makes permanent.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. You know.
Okay, Mona, the silent.
So. What you're saying is,
I can see his wheels turning. I know, yes, I'm afraid where this is going.
What you're saying? No, but see, I'm going to get back to the sex thing, right? Go. Get back to the sex thing.
This is not the topic of the conversation, sir.
No, but it has it has something to do with, you know, color.
Okay.
So I blame a lot of it on porn.
Okay.
Know, as the industry have grown. Of course, there's a lot more black women than it was 25, 35, 40 years ago. So, you know, when you're watching porn, you know, back in the day, you saw nothing but white women being really, really freaky, really sexual. Mm-hmm. And even though it's a lot of acting, I wouldn't mind, you know, us men wouldn't mind performing like that. Like, you know, you see this girl, the happy ending. That's like the greatest fucking thing in the world. Do you know how hard it is to convince a black woman to let you come on her face? She's scared you're going to get that shit on her fucking hair because, you know, she just got it done. It's sewn in or it's glued in. She can't get in the fucking shower. So you look at the white woman and you're like, damn, she's just getting the shower and that shit is done. And a lot of black men mind, and, you know, colored people mind, is like, damn, yo, I can have a happy ending with my white woman and she getting the shower and we can still go to the movies. If you accidentally say y'all ain't using protection and you pull out and you bust and that shit hit her in the fucking face, she's losing her damn mind. She's checking to see if the shit is in her fucking hair. She wants, oh my God. It is what it is. And how many white women come to bed with a fucking scarf?
Hold. Time out on that. Time out on that.
So and the time has come.
Miss Fern or anything. Our hair is different. You understand? It's a culture difference. So if I had hair like Miss Fern, by all means, I wouldn't come to bed with a scarf on my head and all that kind of stuff. Our texture is different. We have to protect it different. So all that you're talking about is nonsense. It's nonsense to me.
You have to defend it. I get it, but it's the truth.
No, but again,
this is where communication comes into play. So if you are a man and that's what you want to bust on her face, as you said, your words, baby, put a scarf on.
Exactly.
It's going to be a little messy tonight.
Exactly.
COVID shield on.
Right.
The
COVID-19 shield on your face.
Or you know, put a shower cap on, or, you know.
You're taking away from it. Because a lot of it is really visual. It's not even the act. It's the fact that I'm doing it and you receiving it. If you got a scarf on, that's fucking me up. That it's like you know, you're washing windows in your house, like you're doing chores and shit. You know what I'm saying? But I just wanted to put that out there, you know, something for y'all to think about, you know. Stop mm-hmm. wearing scarves to be. Mm-hmm.
You know what? It's a lot of things I can say about men and what they won't do and what they and all that.
Hello.
We can talk about that another time. You know, that right there, that's just so low standard of...
No. But that's I'm just being
dead serious. Because I'm like, see, if you had to it, whether my hair...
But is he the one paying to get her hair done, though? You know what I'm saying?
And that's my thing. That's my thing. It's a difference in the texture of the hair. So, of course, if you want to keep paying for my hair every other day, do what you got to do, bro. Look, as long as you got that money right there and I can go to that hairdresser or get my hair done.
I just wanted to throw that out there. I struck a nerve. I struck a black nerve.
You did. Yes,
I struck
you
a
did.
Black nerve.
Yes, you
but
did.
I'm just being honest. When, like
and I'm being honest as well. Like I said, do what you got to do. But you got to realize that with that black woman, the ones that do care, because all black women don't care about that. All women don't care about that, but the ones
not all of them.
Their money so they can go to the hairdresser to get their hair done again. Because you got to realize, hair done is like $150, boo.
I don't know what woman
messing that up. No, sir.
But I don't know what woman is going to give you that whole porn vibe because that's just not real life. You understand? Like that's I don't care how freaky you think your girl. You can make all the faces that you want to. Like. It's just not real life. Not on the everyday. That is, you might get that for your birthday.
Right.
Once a year, but that's not every day.
Not every day.
Okay.
Secure your bag.
Not every day.
And again, it goes back to what you're bringing. You know what I mean? Like, what are you doing to make her become a porn star?
Drinking lots of water.
Nothing. He ain't doing nothing. Running his mouth.
Listen, you can't be coming in the bedroom with your slides on.
Right.
Your little box of briefs. Like, it's just not happening.
Right.
With your dad bod.
I'm boring as hell. I come and take the towel off. I'm like, let's get it. You know what I mean? I'm
That's
boring.
That's what I'm saying. And he wants somebody doing stunts and shows and spinning poles.
You know? Hey, come to bed, fire, like, breathing.
Oh, my
like,
God.
Yeah,
you got 1 minute. 1 minute. That's all you got out of me. Boy, bye. Go sleep.
Damn.
I'm gonna give you the best 30 seconds of your life, though.
Right.
Woo.
And I'm looking at
the happy ending. I'm good.
I'm still ready, and you knocked out sleep. I mean, what the problem? Right.
I'm not gonna say nothing. No. PRS1, you talk the rest of the show. I'm.
You went there. You wanted to bring it back up. You opened up the box. Sir.
Yep.
You better be nice. Like, if your wife is watching, you may not be able to go home tonight.
I'm putting my mask on. I'm done.
He got a permanent spot on the couch. He got a permanent spot. When he comes in the door, the pillow and the blanket is right there for him.
You were supposed to write Good Vibes TV on your mask, sir.
Yeah, I stay in the door. I make it interesting to come home at night sometimes.
Right.
Yeah. But that's just such a... But that is such a man thing to say. You expect, you know, the woman to be out at work, cook, can come home, cook for the family, you know, and then be a porn star by like 8 o'clock at night. Like, that's just not realistic.
It's not, that's why a lot of, and I hate to say it, but if you talk to, because I got a good friend of mine, he will say it. I can get that from a white woman.
No, you can't.
No.
He's a liar. No, you can't.
Y'all know who that friend is, too.
Mm. Yeah. It's called paid. It's called getting paid, like paying them. Sure.
Ooh.
You can get anything that you're paying for. So.
Absolutely.
I'm just saying.
Whoa. We got some comments.
And that doesn't necessarily mean a typical prostitute. He could be a sugar daddy. He could be supporting her, you know? Yeah, a woman that's got no job and nothing to do but please her man, by all means.
Yeah, jump off that pole.
Listen, I've always said, if my man is out working and I'm home, the least thing I can do is have a hot meal on the table for him, his house cleaned, and whatever else the man might need. Just say.
Yes.
Yep. I agree.
My stimulus check, baby.
But, you know, now that we're equal and we're both working and we got kids to take care of and a household to take care of, like, no. No, you go ahead and get that from that white woman. Tell me how that works out for you.
Yeah.
I got Ms. Hillard on here saying we take care of our hair once we pay to get it done and we're not messing it up to please you. If you got a problem with that scarf, exit stage left.
Listen, I'm actually jealous. I'm jealous that black women look so good in their scarves. Like, they don't even have to fix their hair. And first of all, most black women don't have to wear makeup. They have a beautiful complexion. They don't have to do their hair. They can throw it up in a scarf. They can just get up and go, where I have to spend over an hour, you know what I mean, to get myself together. So...
Yeah, and I'm glad you said that, because there's a lot of black women think the opposite.
Right. Yes, Lord, they walk around looking like a funeral home and did their makeup.
Right.
But you know what? That don't have nothing to do, Ramon, they don't have nothing to do with a black or white thing, because if a woman don't know how to put on makeup, it's going to look crazy. Because you're black.
Right.
I mean, I'm going to tell you the truth. I used to think that heavy eyeliner that Hispanic women wore was crazy. Until someone told me why they did that. Because I'm like, why they want to look
like that? Why do they do that?
Right.
Yeah, exactly. Y'all talking about a certain supervisor that used to work on my shift. But anyway.
Ooh, but no, don't do that. No. Ms. Fern, it was the ones that I'm speaking about is because of the set that they came from. They wore a certain way. But to me, I was like, that doesn't even, as a female, it didn't look attractive. You know what
I
mean? So, because I'm a female that, I love beautiful women. That's just it. I don't care who you know, what color you are. If you're beautiful, I'm going to tell you that. But if it looks crazy, I don't care if you're black, white, Hispanic, Chinese, whatever. You look crazy if you don't know what you're doing.
There was a model back in the 90s. I forgot her name, but I believe she might have been from Nigeria or one of the countries in Africa. I'm not 100% certain. Her skin complexion, it was like butter, baby.
She was Naomi Campbell?
It wasn't Naomi Campbell, no.
Okay.
But her skin complexion, she was very, she was dark.
Right.
She had a dark complexion, but it was almost like it glowed. I can't even explain it to you in words. It was a complexion that we're not used to seeing. You know, we usually see, especially in the entertainment industry, you know, light skin, you know, fair, you know, that caramel color. Mm-hmm. But this particular woman, no, sir. This particular
like
woman,
Grace Jones, black type.
Yes.
Oh,
mm-hmm. My gosh! It was just so exquisite. Like I just can't even explain it in words. I was obsessed with it, because it was just so beautiful to me. You know, her skin looked just so soft and just like shiny and like not a single flaw in her complexion. I just love, you know.
And I think a lot of black women are they're so insecure with the way they look or how they think they should look.
That's women, period.
Media.
That's-
and I think it's because of TV and media and all that stuff. They get, you know, the white girls have it easy. We have to do all this work. No, everybody's beautiful in their own way. Black people are beautiful in their own way. White people are beautiful in their own way. Women are beautiful. I mean, sometimes you see a beautiful woman and the first thing you say is, there is a God. You know what I mean? That's when you realize God is really alive. You know what I mean? It doesn't matter sometimes, you know. And women, a lot of women spend too much time.
To piggyback on what you were just saying, white women.
Freezing up.
Go ahead.
To piggyback on what you just said about black women being insecure, white women are just as insecure. You know, we're not embraced. If a white woman has curves, we're not embraced for those. You're told at 17 years old, you know, I had like a size 29 waist with like a size 40 hip. You know what I mean? Like that, I'm not kidding you. And that was even before J-Lo put that on the map. So for me, I would wear baggy clothes and I would try to hide it. And I was always embarrassed. And I was always like, oh my gosh, like something's wrong with me. But that's just how my body is built. You know, I have no control over that. And so in my culture, the white men I would be considered fat. I would be considered, you know, all these different things. Now, you know what I mean? Now it's more culturally acceptable on both ends. Because of Jennifer Lopez, because of Kim Kardashian, because of these, you know, the way these models are, they're all getting their butt injected and all these other different things. And I'm not saying that Kim and J-Lo are the ones that, you know, this is what's always been in the African-American culture is, you know, big hips and you know, the flat stomachs that the men have really embraced. But so now it's more culturally acceptable, but white women are just as hard on each other, you know, with their bodies, and they're just as insecure that things were not always accepted the way, you know, things that were accepted with the women in the black culture was not accepted with women in the, and, you know, we're the ones that always have the eating disorders because we always have to be a specific weight, you know?
Yep, absolutely.
And I'd just say, I like my curves now. I'm just not feeling the speed bumps. Just saying.
You got any pictures from back in the day?
No. None that you're going to see, sir.
Okay.
Just ask. Let's try, bro. Well, we got about 5 more minutes here, so I don't know.
Max, I gave up the porn stars.
So let's say, you know, we can wrap it up. We have about 5 more minutes left on the show. We just want to thank everybody who was looking, you know, who's on Facebook for your comments. Ms. Betram, Ms. Hillard, Ms. Nunu, Mikey. Who else is on here? A bunch of folks is on here. And we can just wrap it up, say what we do and what y'all got planned coming up. Any projects, anything?
Well, you know, take it away. Basically, I got the same thing going on. I don't want to have to keep repeating back because I know y'all probably.
Hey, you got new people watching all the time. But, so go ahead.
we're still working on our show, Savvy Powell's Fashion Statement 2, November the 14th. We're still looking for vendors. So if you're an entrepreneur and you want to promote your brand, you can hit me up on my IG page at Savvy Events 1987 and Facebook. Just my name, Savanya McIntosh, and leave me a message and I'll get back to you and explain to you what you need to do if you want to become a vendor. Also, like I said, I'm working with 2 other people, one in upstate New York and Atlanta. Hopefully, you know, they gave me the green light. If everything still go as planned, I'll be traveling down there and helping them with 2 shows. And as I said, I think last week, we have t-shirts. I'm supposed to have one on today, but I didn't receive it, so I will have it next week. And I think Mr. Ramon is going to have one as well to purchase. And we still selling our cups. And I have everybody cup. I have to give them give it out to you. I'm sorry, I'm stumbling over my words today. So so that's what I got going on. Like I said, I do have a new artist. He don't mind me saying that. He just don't want us to put it out there right now because we're working on some stuff together. So, but I'm really excited about working with him. And I think that's it. Oh, and I'm looking forward to this 20 episode of Good Vibes Television.
All right. Well, ladies first, Ms. Fern, what you got going on?
Oh, gosh. What don't I have going on? So I'm getting ready to launch my business. It's called Grow with Fern. So basically, anything that you need, you can grow. Your money, your network, your mindset. Little play on my name. I'm also working with an artist. His name is Mark M.K. He's a pretty dope artist. We've got those together. He was actually just on the BET Awards, in the opening segments of the BET Awards. I'm working with some pretty dope people in investing, and you know, if you just need to get in contact with me, you want to, you know, network, you want to you know, plug into some of the connections that I might have, you know, definitely hit me up. You can hit me up on Instagram at ferngully _75, and yeah, looking forward to networking with everyone.
All right. Well, from my side of it, I'm, you know, pretty much Trini Spice FM. That's what I'm doing. We basically do Caribbean music. You guys want to hear it? I got a whole station you can listen to called Trini Spice FM. It's available on your iOS and Android platforms for free. Just download the app, Trini Spice FM. Hear all the Caribbean vibes you want to hear. Good vibes. Mo, you can shut it down for now.
My name is Ramon Lindsay. me and my sons, we run the company Royal Legend. This upcoming fall, we'll have we'll start our clothing line, Royal Legend. I have a book that will be released soon called Why Good Men Hate Women. And just really excited about GVTV and the direction it's going. Looking forward to the 20th episode as well. Ms. Betray, hit me up. I'm actually in your area again. I have your mug with me, so I can drop it off to you. I want to thank Ms. Fern for taking time out of her busy day to sit and talk to us. Time with us, you know.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, absolutely. So, please come back. Come back with pictures.
Before we all shut it out, hey, can we tell them what the last episode, some of the sneak peeks, what we might have going on for the last episode? You guys want to really tune in for?
Let Savvy do it, because apparently I done got it all wrong. I done told people it's a pajama party. It's going to be crazy, like 40, 50 people, no social distancing. So I'm not even going to comment on what it's going to be. I'm going to let Savvy speak on that.
I know. My wife asked me, when is the party?
Yeah, so it's a pajama party. There'll be half-naked people there. Don't ask me, because I got it all wrong.
Yep, people going to be wearing scarves.
Ramon, on a quick side note, that book you got, you definitely need to get in contact with me. I can get that to be a bestseller for you.
There you go. Right.
That's what networking is all about.
Oh, yes, it is.
Yes.
You definitely need to connect.
Right, so the 20th episode really supposed to be about learning how to be intimate and different ways that you can be intimate with your partner. I don't know where he got this. We're going to have a pajama jam, and we're going to have orgies and all this good stuff going on.
Wishful thinking and stuff.
Right, but it is going to be a little out there, because we want people to really get in touch with their sexuality. You know, a lot of us are so afraid. Most men, they're so afraid of that. So we have some special guests that's going to come on and show us how to do that. You know, show us how to get outside of ourselves to be able to please your partner. So this is what the show is. No sex orgy and having all these toys flying around in the air and people swinging some poles. I know you would want that, Ramon, but we can't. Look, y'all too married. I need y'all, and I don't want y'all.
We're not gonna be allowed to come back.
I can't do that. But it's gonna be a little breaky, and we can invite some people. I mean, it's our choice to invite some people to join in, because we're gonna need people to show this stuff on. So yeah, yep. And we all going to be dressed up in pajamas. Well, come, if the ones that we are inviting, come with your sexy.
Yeah, we'll also be doing nipple piercings for those that would like to partake in the piercing.
See, that's what I'm saying.
What if you already have them?
Then we are having nipple sucking contests.
Miss Rosie, I had nothing to do with that. You know, I just don't. You know, I'm not going to do that.
God.
Right, I'm going to be in the good room. Well, he in the other room, okay? And I'm taking all pictures and videos.
I'm being the goody.
He ain't gonna be in no room. I'm telling you right now, his wife ain't gonna let him go nowhere.
Right. I'm taking pictures and everything for blackmail. Just want y'all.
Trust and believe. She'll be with me.
Good.
Mm-hmm. She ain't gonna let me go. She'll be with me.
Good. That's how it should be.
Right.
Short leash.
Right. It's educational, guys. It's educational.
All right, Mo. We can wrap it up.
Hey, so thank you to everybody who supported us the last 18 weeks, got us to where we are. We love you. Thank you for tuning in. Till next week, GVTV. Peace.
Bye, guys.